My name is David Coplow. I'm a professor at the Georgetown Law Center. It is my great privilege to serve as the moderator for this first panel in the program in celebration of the work and the life of our beloved colleague, mentor, friend, Drew Christiansen. The subject of our first panel today is nuclear weapons getting beyond the current impasse. And I think it's useful to remember at the outset that there are multiple pathways, multiple intellectual traditions that can bring one to a concern about nuclear weapons. For some people, it's about strategy and international politics. For some people, the starting point is economics and injustice. For some people, it's law and equality around the world. For some people, it's ethics and morality. For Drew Christiansen, almost uniquely, he was able to draw on all of those traditions and more in recognition, I think, of the Jesuit tradition of curia personalis, the care for the whole person. And Drew was able to draw upon and manifest all those different traditions in his work. The panel will proceed today. First, I'll introduce all the four speakers, and I want to commend the organizers for bringing together speakers who draw upon all those different traditions in their own work, and we hope in the presentations today. I'll introduce all four briefly, too briefly, in view of their many qualifications and credentials for participation in this work, but we want to get to as much time as possible in the discussion. And they will each have then 10 minutes or so for opening remarks. We'll then have more discussion among the panel and open it for questions and discussion with the entire group. The sharp-eyed among you, the numerically oriented among you, will have noticed that I spoke about four panelists. We have three on the stage here today. The first panelist, Marty Hellman, is unable to join us in person today from California, so we're going to present his work through the miracle of video recording. Marty is a professor emeritus of electrical engineering at Stanford University. He's affiliated with their Center on International Security and Cooperation. He is known to many as a cryptologist for his involvement in public key cryptography and his leadership in the computer privacy debate and his application of risk analysis to the problems of nuclear deterrence. Among his many honors include membership of the National Academy of Engineering and his award of the ACM Turing Award, the top prize in computer science. After Marty's video, we'll have Dr. Marianne Cusimano-Love. She is an associate professor of international relations at Catholic University. She serves the Holy See mission to the United Nations on nuclear issues. She participated in the negotiation of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty Review Conference and the negotiations for the treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. And she serves on the board of the Arms Control Association, Pope Francis's New Technologies for Peace Task Force, and the board of Catholic Peacebuilding Network. She's a New York Times bestselling author. Her recent books include Global Issues Beyond Sovereignty in 2020. Next is Jonathan Granoff. He is the president of the Global Security Initiative, a senior advisor and representative of the United Nations, represented to the United Nations of the World Summits of Nobel Peace Laureates, and himself a Nobel Peace nominee in 2014. He's a senior advisor to the Committee on National Security of the International Law Section of the American Bar Association, which honored him in 2020 with its Lifetime Achievement Award. And he is most recently a newly appointed permanent observer at the United Nations, for the International Anti-Corruption Academy. And finally, Douglas Shaw is a consultant on nuclear weapons and a research professor of international affairs at the George Washington University's Elliott School of International Affairs. He previously served at the Department of Energy to secure nuclear weapons usable nuclear material from theft or diversion in Ukraine, and at the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency on nuclear nonproliferation. He's also served in leadership roles at several non-governmental organizations, including today the Nuclear Threat Initiative, Physicians for Social Responsibility, and the Lawyers Alliance for World Security. Let's begin with the video from Marty Hellman.
Thank you very much. I'm honored to participate in this conference honoring the memory and work of Father Drew Christiansen. His passion for human rights, peacemaking, and eliminating the nuclear threat all relate to my talk, whose title, Rethinking National Security, is taken from my project of the same name. And the written version of this talk will have links to a number of things like that project and reports that I referred to. That project starts with national security, because that's where most people are right now. But it really is about international security of all nations, as the following questions from its summary statement make clear. In this age of nuclear weapons, pandemics, cyber attacks, terrorism, and environmental crises, is national security becoming inseparable from global security? And if so, how do our current policies need to change? This project isn't pie in the sky, and that summary statement has been signed by, among others, a former Secretary of Defense, a former director of NSA, and a former chairman of the National Intelligence Council. My report, which again, there's a link in the written version of this talk, my report on rethinking national security goes into more detail by examining a dozen assumptions that masquerade as self-evident truths, but that turn out to be highly questionable on closer examination. In this talk, I only have time to explore the most fundamental of them, namely that national security can be bought at the expense of other nations. While that's often true in the short term, that assumption becomes highly questionable when viewed longer term. As one example, to minimize the damage that our nation suffers from pandemics, we have to work cooperatively with other nations, even our adversaries. That's because a hotspot anywhere can quickly spread worldwide, as has already happened, resulting in more American deaths than from combat in all of our wars. And economically depressed North Korea proves that almost any nation that truly desires nuclear weapons can obtain them. While other considerations played a role in transforming that nation into the nuclear-armed menace that it is today, our focus on national security was one of the most important factors. Thinking short term and only in terms of our own security led us to seek crippling sanctions and to encourage regime change. Fear then led North Korea's leadership to seek a nuclear deterrent capable of hitting the American homeland. That's the only way they can deter us. So unless it's truly in our vital interest to do otherwise, we should treat every nation with the respect it would deserve if it already had nuclear weapons. Otherwise, we will unwittingly encourage nuclear proliferation and additional threats to our own national security. The time to treat a nation with respect is before it has nuclear weapons, not after. And unfortunately, we often fail to treat even nuclear-armed nations with adequate respect. We tend to act as if we really were the world's only superpower, whereas in reality, we are only the world's sole conventional superpower. The risk of confusing those two can be seen in a March 2021 paper, which explained why the risk of a major nuclear war was then equivalent to playing a global version of Russian roulette with a nuclear-armed gun about once every 15 years. A few months later, former Secretary of Defense Bill Perry told me that he agreed with my estimate and gave me permission to quote him. Now, I should note that those who say that a nuclear war is unlikely are really correct. That's because there are 5 chances out of 6 that you survive a game of Russian roulette. But even one nuclear bullet brings too much risk, especially since that trigger is being pulled approximately 5 times over the lifetime of a child born today. In an October 2022 report, so just last month, also linked to in the write-up of this talk, I updated that estimate to account for the war in Ukraine. I now estimate that we're pulling the trigger about once a year, once every year that the war drags on. And the current prognosis is, unfortunately, for such a prolonged war. When confronted with the specter of nuclear war, many people understandably jump to nuclear disarmament as the solution. If there were no nuclear weapons, the reasoning goes, there couldn't be a nuclear war. But the real solution is both bigger and smaller. It's bigger because it involves a long-range process that requires fundamental changes in how we think about national security. That's the essence of rethinking national security. Yet it's also smaller because the first steps in that process are possible in the current environment, which nuclear disarmament is not. To prevent early steps from obscuring the ultimate goal of reaching a level of acceptable risk, I've defined an intermediate goal of 1,000 warheads worldwide, as indicated in this figure. And it's also discussed in detail of section 6 of my aforementioned October 2022 report. This diagram also shows why many people fail to see both the risk of World War III and the possibility of resolving the nuclear threat. There are no direct paths from anywhere within the world as we know it, that big circle in the center, to either of those outcomes. But as the Cuban Missile Crisis shows all too well, it is possible to take steps in the negative direction, steps between the small dots in that diagram, which bring previously inconceivable possibilities into view. If enough such steps are taken, we can come dangerously close to the nuclear threshold, as happened in 1962. In the same way, steps in the positive direction can create new and better possibilities. If enough such steps are taken, we can cross into a world vastly different, vastly better than any we've known. This is the circle labeled new thinking in the diagram, with the ultimate goal being the end state labeled acceptable risk. To move in that positive direction, the first critical step is for society to recognize the unacceptable level of risk that it currently faces. Until that's accomplished, there will be inadequate interest in alternatives to the nuclear status quo. A second key step is for society to recognize that three goals, which are usually seen as separate, are really inextricably intertwined and really follow one another. First, developing more rational foreign policy. Second, building a more peaceful world. And finally, eliminating the nuclear threat. Only after the first two are realized will specific proposals for eliminating the threat be seriously considered. Those are daunting tasks, but a number of reasons for hope are outlined in section 7 of my report. One example explained there in more detail is that we are already 40% of the way from the peak of the arms race to the intermediate goal of 1,000 warheads worldwide. Contrary to the usual feeling that we're not making progress, we're really almost halfway there. Of course, and as noted earlier, the war in Ukraine is a huge setback that has greatly increased the nuclear risk. But even there, there is hope if we will only open our eyes. A June 2022 poll in Ukraine, sponsored by the Wall Street Journal and supervised by the University of Chicago, not surprisingly found that 85% of Ukrainians see Russia as responsible for the war. But 70% say the same about their own government, and 58% about the US. Most Americans will be perplexed by those numbers, but that's a sign that we need to learn more, not that the poll is wrong. In the Gospels, in Matthew 7:3, Jesus basically asks, "Why do you take note of the splinter in your brother's eye, but do not notice the 2x4 in your own?" Since our brother in Ukraine is Vladimir Putin, he probably has a 4x8 in his eye, not a splinter. So the solution that follows in Matthew 7:5 might better be phrased thusly. First, remove the 2x4 from your own eye, and then you will be able to see clearly enough to remove the 4x8 from your brother's eye. Right now, there is such horror over the atrocities in Ukraine that anyone who speaks of peace risks being branded as a Russian stooge. But again, paraphrasing Matthew, this time 5:9, Jesus didn't say, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called Russian stooges." No, instead he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God." If enough of us will aspire to that exalted state, I believe that Father Drew's spirit will break into a broad smile as his work on earth is taken up by others. Thank you.
And I think our only regret that Marty will not be here today to engage in the conversation with us, but we have others who are. Marianne.
Thank you, David. As Marty mentioned, we are at a very difficult time right now. As Putin threatens nuclear war, the risks of nuclear weapons use and radiological explosions are higher than at any time since the Cuban Missile Crisis. Now, the good news is that we have seen some momentum, some movement. that our moral norms regarding nuclear weapons use and possession have changed, and our legal norms around nuclear weapons have changed. But the challenge is, while our moral and legal norms are changing with an assist from the Catholic Church, our policies are still stuck. So we have this gap between the movement we've seen on the moral change that David started us off talking about, the legal change, and these stuck-in-the-mud policies. So how do we bridge this gap? How do we move it forward? What are the models for moving beyond deterrence and models for moving beyond the impasse? My remarks today are coming from a book I'm writing, should be out, I hope, next year on my sabbatical year, God and the Bomb. But two of the chapters are in Drew's last book, which will be coming out. I shouldn't say last book. Drew's next book, which will be coming out in 2003. The chapters that I contributed, but many other contributors are here with us today to that book. So we can look forward to that. Here's my bottom line up front. To move towards deeper disarmament, we need to build deeper relationships. And to do that, just peace principles and practices are a means to do that. They have worked in the past. They were very effective in what we call the golden age of nuclear disarmament. And they can work for us again in the future. They're not only morally the right thing to do, they are strategically the right thing to do. This is strategic peace building, to draw connections between locals at the grassroots, what we heard earlier of Drew always paying attention to the people experiencing the conflict. Strategic peace building is drawing those connections between the local communities experiencing the conflict and elites at the government or intergovernmental actor levels. So these mechanisms and methods and principles of just peace that I'll trace out, participation, restoration, right relationship, reconciliation, and sustainability, they're not only good morally, but they are good strategically. And that's what we need to use to move us away from nuclear Armageddon that Marty was warning us about and towards a more just and sustainable peace. Over 25 years ago, when I first graduated and moved to Washington, D.C., one of the first friends I made was Father Drew Christiansen. And it was my great privilege to work closely with him on precisely these issues we're discussing here today, how to move beyond the impasse and move towards deeper disarmament over all that time period. We've had some successes along the way, one of which was I was privileged to work with him and Pierce and others to represent the Holy See mission at the United Nations in those discussions on the treaty to ban a nuclear weapon, the treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. So that is one of the advancements that we've seen. Nuclear weapons are now illegal, following the other humanitarian arms control agreements and closing the legal loophole that had existed where other weapons of mass destruction had been banned. Now nuclear weapons, as of last year, are all, when the treaty entered into force, are also illegal. One of the things I think that's important to note of how that treaty came to pass and what was different in the process of that treaty than other arms control treaties is one of the mechanisms that I'm talking about of just peace, expanding participation, is precisely what was done at the Ban Treaty conference and negotiations. It was in other nuclear arms treaties, it is the governments who have the nuclear weapons sitting around and talking with the other governments who have nuclear weapons and deciding whether the U.S. and Russia will limit or control or decline their numbers. This time, you had people who were impacted by nuclear weapons, the victims of nuclear weapons, those who'd experienced the environmental, the humanitarian harms, speaking of their experiences. That changed things. It changed the type of discussion we had, and it certainly changed the outcome in getting those weapons banned. So we have the ban treaty now. We have the morality question moving. As we said, Pope Francis continuing the movement we've seen for over 20 years, where Pope John Paul II, where Pope Benedict, and now Francis institutionalized it more, said it is immoral not only to use nuclear weapons, but also to possess them, okay? That was very much to the consternation of some who were using the U.S. Bishop's 1983 Challenge of Peace pastoral as a fig leaf, that this should somehow meant nuclear weapons were always and forever moral and blessed by the bishops, which, of course, is not what that statement said. But Francis has clarified that for us. Okay, so we have this movement on the moral and the legal side, and I contend that just peace tradition presents us a way to move beyond this policy impact. First, I want to take, as the lawyers here will appreciate, the contrary side. Many would argue that's insane. We've just discussed how a challenging precipice we are of facing the potential of nuclear Armageddon. Now is not the time for turning to just peace traditions or practices. We have to wait until the conditions are right in order to do deeper disarmament and deeper diplomacy. That is absolutely incorrect. The way to make the conditions right is to work through dialogue, through diplomacy, through development, through these tactics of just peace to better the conditions. You don't sit around and wait until fairies and unicorns suddenly make the conditions better. You have to do some hard work. The other reason, though, to remember is that peace building works particularly when the conditions are bad. That is when this toolbox, what I call the peace building toolbox, was meant to work, when conditions are poor. That's when you use these tools. So it is not at all disqualifying to say we're at war in Ukraine and we're facing these nuclear threats. Now is not the time. It's actually the perfect time. We should not let this crisis go to waste. Do not waste a good crisis. I don't mean good in any way for the poor people of Ukraine. What I mean is that this can be a tipping point, a leverage point. If you need a point to motivate or mobilize change, a crisis can be that point when people can look for different alternatives and when, as Marty said, the problems with the status quo become very apparent. So for moving forward, as I mentioned, participation is key. The TPNW expanded participation. But another thing to remember with participation, sometimes this is looked at, discredited as being something PC that you do for politically correct purposes, for the optics. It would look better to have more diversity around the table. It would look better for the Women, Peace, and Security agenda to have more youth, more women, more minorities, more of the people impacted by nuclear weapons, that this is about optics. Participation and expanding participation is not about the optics, okay? It is strategic. It is about expanding the constituents for peace. And if you're at an impasse, and we're talking about ways to break the impasse, you can't break the impasse with the same people who gave you the impasse. You have to expand the voices, expand the table, expand the participation to get a different outcome. So I mentioned the TPNW as a way to expand participation. There are also ways with reconciliation, which includes truth-telling and public acknowledgement, that we see civil society actors increasingly playing a part in transparency, verifiability on arms control agreements. So whether it's the GO4 non-probe by the James Martin Center, looking at ways to examine to do crowdsourcing on nuclear non-proliferation and transparency and verification. I'm sure Doug might mention some of the things that NTI was working on, expanding civil society's participation in these efforts. We'll hear later today in the next panel from some efforts to expand cooperative security, different channels. So Ambassador Goodby will tell us about the OSCE and the opportunities that may provide. We may hear from Daryl about the Deep Cuts Commission or from Doug about the European Leadership Network. All of those are methods to expand cooperative security channels. The second part of Just Peace is restoration of the human infrastructure, not just roads and bridges. As all of you know, we did some of this after the end of the Cold War with the cooperative threat reduction programs for military and defense conversion, and Doug participated in some of those efforts through the Department of Energy. What you may not be aware of is that in addition to that, we had really a whole of government effort, and and many government agencies were active in this. So the U.S. Agency for International Development immediately hit the road and tried to find apartments for Soviet military officers so that they would want to come back to Moscow because they imagined that it could be a problem if these military officers stayed in military communities in the newly independent states. That proved to be very prescient, that those communities could cause problems later on. U.S. General Milley often remarks that if we fail to fully resource diplomacy and development, if we don't give the resources necessary for diplomacy and development, then he, as a general, will need a bigger budget for ammunition. That is absolutely true. We had a very small budget, unfortunately, for these excellent programs in restoration, over $20 billion over a period of 20 years. That went to over 18 different countries of the former Soviet Empire as well as the former Soviet states. That was incredibly well-used money for defense conversion, taking nuclear submarine factories and turning them to make air conditioners or refrigerators. But it wasn't enough. And now those programs with Russia were stopped in 2012 by Putin. Some of those continue in the other states. But now we're paying the ammunition bill, okay? We're paying $64 billion a year for our nuclear weapons, $82.5 billion a year globally for the nuclear weapons, and just this year, over $20 billion to give military assistance to Ukraine. If we cannot build that political will to fully resource development and diplomacy, we will continue to pay the ammunition bill. And that is not a great way to build relationships and to do strategic peace building. One more point on this. We've spent resources to doing defense conversion in the former Soviet states. We never did it at home within the United States, in all of the places where nuclear weapons were built and that continue to rely on those military budgets in very low-income communities. So Archbishop Wester of the Diocese of Santa Fe, New Mexico, issued a pastoral letter, Living in the Light of Christ's Peace, a conversation towards nuclear disarmament. And he argues that if we want to reduce nuclear weapons and get rid of the nuclear weapons in his diocese, it will absolutely require economic development aid to the very poor indigenous communities in New Mexico. Google nuclear weapons near me. You'll come up with a map of all of the sites in the United States that are communities that are dependent on those streams of income. So I would challenge people from Dorothy Day, a Catholic worker, or Mayors for Peace, or some of the advocates who do more witness-based work, be more strategic in your work. Look at how we can get perhaps some of the money that's coming now in the infrastructure bill, in the green energy transition bill. Can that money be funneled to those communities here in the United States that also need defense conversion? Finally, we've mentioned how reconciliation includes truth-telling, public acknowledgement, how there's avenues for civil society to take more engagement in that. Finally, though, sustainability. The United States spends over $6 billion per year cleaning up our nuclear weapons compounds, the cleaning up the bill of our nuclear weapons from the Cold War. It is the largest environmental cleanup on planet Earth. That is not a great expenditure of our resources. Instead, we should be making sure we don't have more nuclear weapons, so we're not doing that. Sustainability is not only about environmental sustainability, though. It's also about the sustainability of these human relationships. So I would contend that if we want to carry forward Drew Christiansen's legacy, we are his legacy. The connections between all of us are his legacy, as much as his academic tomes and as much as his policy work. So to carry forward his legacy, we have to carry forward this building of relationships that he spent his entire life working to build these relationships. These relationships are what we base peace on. These relationships is what moves a just peace forward. So the risk is high, as Marty's told us. There's plenty of work for all of us. We need all hands on deck to build a more just and sustainable peace.
Thank you. Our next speaker will be Jonathan Granoff, and I should insert here that I've learned that it's not so complimentary to refer to someone as an old friend. You're supposed to say it's a person who's been a friend for a very long time. And that's what Jonathan is.
Thank you, David. David's more than a friend. David is one of the top, and he's not going to share his extraordinary wisdom, insights, and scholarship in the field of international law. But maybe some of you will ask him questions. I want to start with some truths. Truths matter. I think. One truth is that we've learned that a small portion of the nuclear arsenal going off, less than 1% of the arsenal, would throw at least 5 million tons of soot into the stratosphere and end modern civilization as we understand it. A small portion of the arsenal. We know that we're destroying species at minimally 1,000 times the evolutionary base rate. Some scientists say it's 10,000 times the evolutionary base rate. Humanity has wiped out 60% of the mammals, birds, fish, and reptiles since 1970. Deforestation has wiped out 8% of the Amazon rainforest since 2000. The last decade was the hottest decade since record keeping began. The Earth has lost 28 trillion tons of ice since the mid-1990s. I just want to say I had the privilege of being in an expedition up beyond the polar ice cap and seeing hunks of ice the size of New York office buildings collapsing into huge rivers of pure water that had been frozen for since time immemorial. I didn't really grasp the magnitude until I saw it, then heard it, and then saw what was happening. I could go on. I don't think I need to talk about the nature of the Anthropocene, the age we live in today, in which the human impact of science, technology, and social organization is actually determining evolution on the planet and making humanity an endangered species. This is a fact. This is something that cannot be avoided. We don't have political institutions to protect our third lung, the phytoplankton of the oceans that depends on the pH of the oceans, which provides 50 to 70% of our oxygen. If I were to lose a lung or you were to lose a lung, you could live. But if the third lung that we all share is destroyed because we destroy the acidic alkaline balance of the oceans, we can't breathe. These are facts. These are facts that should be front and center in the news every day. And as to each and every one of these, they cannot be solved at the level of the nation state. The Westphalian model, which is a horse and buggy model of the 17th century that defines security based on a human creation of the 17th century, designed to stop the slaughter of people in Central Europe over whose definition of Jesus' love was preferred. Imagine that. I mean, we're not the first generation of folly. That model is still the model that we live with. And the model of security's definition comes from a 5th century Roman maxim, prepare for war, receive peace, prepare for peace, receive war. Peace through overwhelming power and force. And now we know that with nuclear weapons, it's an incredible paradox. The more the weapons are perfected, the less security we get. So there's some problems with ideas, and ideas matter. But ideas have to be grounded in the truth, in the reality of the issues we're facing. So I just laid out some scientific truths. Now I want to lay out some truths that guided Drew, that guide me and guide all of us. Love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your might, and like unto that, love your neighbor as yourself. Now, when Jesus said that, neighborhood was not the whole planet because human endeavor couldn't affect the whole planet. But today, how we drive our cars, heat our homes, makes neighborhood a moral location. And it reminds us of another spiritual tradition's truth of the Upanishads, ancient Hindu scripture, that says the human family is one. So this spiritual admonition of seeing our interconnected moral reality has now, for the first time in human history, become a practical necessity. We simply have to cooperate to protect our third lung, to protect ourselves. And the nation state is insufficient to do that. Now, I am certain of this because I have been to all of the nuclear non-proliferation treaty conferences since 1995. I spent the summer a wonderful summer and watching this charade of diplomacy in the 10th review conference of the NPT. And why do I say it was somewhat of a charade? Well, everyone knew at the beginning that there would not be a consensus document, because if there was something that condemned Russia's wrongful intervention in Ukraine, then the Russians would not join. And if it said nothing, the Ukrainians wouldn't join. So there was a whole month of discussion that everyone knew was not going to lead to a consensus document. Albeit there was a little light in it that was meaningful. There was some language in the document that didn't get adopted calling for the reinvigoration of the START process. But more importantly, I sat back and looked at the arc of the treaty, which when it entered into force in 1970, why am I talking about this treaty? Because it is the pillar. It's the third most important legal instrument of the 20th century. The most important is the UN Charter, the second Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which might be more important, actually, from a spiritual point of view. And the third is the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, because absent that treaty, we'd have dozens of nuclear weapon states. So it's very important. And it contained within it a provision that after 25 years, it would be reviewed to be determined whether it would be indefinitely extended for another period of time, or terminated. And in order to get it indefinitely extended, there was negotiations, a quid pro quo, and commitments were made to induce behavior by the nuclear weapon states to 182 other countries, such as a banning of nuclear testing. We haven't delivered on that. Progress on a nuclear weapons-free zone in the Middle East. We haven't delivered on that. Materially lowering the political significance of the weapons, reiterated in review conferences in 2000 and 2010. Literally dozens of substantial commitments that would reduce no country's security, strengthen the rule of law, strengthen international cooperation, and change the landscape of diplomacy. And I'm certain that the diplomats who negotiated these solemn commitments under the obligation of the treaty to negotiate the elimination of nuclear weapons and stop their proliferation did so in good faith and honesty. I know many of them. People here know many of them. I know Professor Koplow was in the Defense Department at the time, and there was sincere effort to have a test ban treaty, which we signed, but we haven't got it ratified. Why? Why could the diplomats negotiate on behalf of their countries and then go back to their capitals and not be able to deliver? This is what I kept asking myself. 2000, 13 practical steps. 2010, more of this, more practical steps that could have made us all safer. Why? Because in the capitals, the pursuit of military advantage overtook cooperative security, common security, and even strategic stability. And more importantly, undermined the very fabric of civilization itself, which is pacta sunt servanda. Promises must be kept. You can't have an economic order in which commercial agreements, treaties amongst businesses are disregarded. You can't have an international order in which people's commitments, the commitments of nations, are not honored. And I thought deeply about what is the problem. And the problem, as far as I'm concerned, is a wrong definition of security. It's not grounded in the reality of the science of the 21st century. It's not grounded in the reality of the moral fabric and wise admonitions of wise and spiritually appropriate guides for human conduct, like Jesus or the Upanishads. It's guided by a 5th century Roman maxim. That's the reality. That's what's taught. It's a Hobbesian worldview. That's not what humans are about. So I looked carefully. Is there another approach? Is there another approach that has been stated by the United Nations? Well, we've had the statement that there has to be. Albert Einstein said the unleashed power of the atom has changed everything.
save our modes of thinking, and thus we drift toward unparalleled catastrophe? Well, the change in the mode of thinking came out of the United Nations Program for Development in the 1990s. In a fabulous analysis by an economist, Mahbub al-Haq, who posed the another paradigm called human security. And human security starts with the premise that human beings need to be the focus of how we define security, the daily life issues of human beings, the security and dignity of each person, economic security, job security, food security, health security, environmental security where you live, personal security in your neighborhood and your community, political security, ability to have rule of law in your life. These are the real securities that people face, and today we can't provide this at a national level. That's a reality. So the United Nations has entered into a contract to advance a program called Human Security for All with the Human Security Trust. There's actually a department in the UN to mainstream the concept of human security. So, well, that sounds very idealistic. Well, it is kind of idealistic. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Wow, when it was said, it sure wasn't self-evident. It didn't include women. It didn't include people of color. It didn't include indigenous people. It didn't even include men without property, white men without property. And yet it has been a compass point of vision and the legitimacy of governance ever since. That's really important, that vision can be compelling, that vision of the ought can create change. So I say to the so-called realists who deny the imperative of global human security to protect the environment, spare me your realism and your dependence on fossil fuel indefinitely. And I say to the realists who say, we can live with the sword of nuclear weapons over our head and not have them used by accident, design, or madness, spare me your realism and tell me about how you're going to protect the third lung. Tell me how you're going to protect the rainforests. Tell me how you're going to address the gross disparities of wealth. And there's a cost of nuclear weapons beyond the extraordinary monetary expenditures. There's a cost of these military expenditures beyond the economic cost, $32 trillion since 2000. The cost is the human cost of institutionalizing adversity and fear. How can we cooperate to address these global threats force us to work as a human family when we're pointing nuclear weapons at each other? I don't see how that's possible. Imagine negotiating a contract to buy a car when you have guns on the table. That is the higher cost that I see, is the idea that we're willing to destroy ourselves and the other, because we know what would happen if we started using the weapons, in order to protect something that we've created, that we would stop the very future of humanity to protect the state, our creation, invented recently. It's a recent invention. So I say we need to step back and say, first and foremost, as Albert Einstein and Bertrand Russell said in their famous manifesto, remember your humanity. That's what human security is about. And I think that's the concept that can create the change that can bring us together. And I think that that takes us back to Jesus' instructions. Love God with all your heart, all soul, all your might. God, as he described it, was love itself. And love your neighbor as yourself. And neighborhood today is the entire planet. Thank you.
And our final speaker is Doug Shaw.
Thank you so much, David. It's a great pleasure to be here with you. I'm humbled and grateful to be part of this celebration of Drew Christiansen's extraordinary life and to extend his legacy forward. I'm very grateful to Father Hollenbach for an dazzling opening set of remarks. And to be here with David and Marianne and Jonathan and Marty on the television, we don't celebrate our nuclear disarmament heroes enough. And so today is really special in that regard, and that we're taking time to do it. Many people have lost hope in the topic I was encouraged to address today, of cooperative security. They see Vladimir Putin's conquest of Ukraine, attempted conquest of Ukraine, underwritten by Russia's massive nuclear arsenal. Chinese intransigence to repeated American entreaties to begin nuclear arms control negotiations, and creeping despair among American leaders that a new nuclear arms race can be averted. Prospects for cooperative action to prevent nuclear war appear dark. President DeGioia often observes that the truth makes demands of us. What does the truth that we are in this dark moment, as close to nuclear Armageddon as we have ever been, what demand does that truth make of us? Next year, we'll celebrate the 40th anniversary of a powerful statement of hope from a similarly dark time, the 1983 Bishop's Pastoral Letter on Nuclear War, The Challenge of Peace, God's Promise, and Our Response. When he was editor of America, Drew called The Challenge of Peace, quote, arguably the most influential social teaching document in late 20th century Catholicism, at least as important as Pacem in Terris. The peace pastoral was discussed around the world and prompted bishops' conferences across Europe to write their own pastoral letters on the ethics of nuclear arms and the Vatican to bring bishops' conferences together to set limits to the discussion, end quote. He found its success, quote, in part in the public discourse and open debate of the drafts of the document. In the end, it was accepted even by many who were critical of the bishops, because the process had engaged them, end quote. According to Drew, quote, a case can be made that it had greater de facto authority than almost any teaching precisely because it had been written with so much public discussion, end quote. It's this type of hard, inclusive cooperation that I argue for today in Drew's memory. The Defense Department just released President Joe Biden's nuclear posture review as part of the 2022 National Defense Strategy. This nuclear posture review, correctly, in the words of Nuclear Threat Initiative board co-chairs Ernest Moniz and Sam Nunn, quote, emphasizes diplomacy, dialogue, arms control, and nonproliferation, along with maintaining a safe and reliable nuclear deterrent, end quote. But it's also resigned to the timeless inevitability of a nuclear triad of intercontinental ballistic missiles, bombers, and submarine-launched ballistic missiles, the threat to use nuclear weapons first, and a global balance of terror threatening all of humanity. These are not timeless truths. We know that political change can make dramatic progress possible toward nuclear disarmament, as it did when the Soviet Union collapsed. We also know that change is always possible and usually happening, and that even at the height of the Cold War, the simple human desire to survive drove cooperation between superpower rivals actively planning each other's total annihilation. Nuclear arms control began in earnest within a year of the Cuban Missile Crisis through the hotline agreement and the partial nuclear test ban, and snowballed into a process that dismantled thousands of nuclear weapons and persists even today despite incredible animosity and total distrust between the governments of Russia and the United States. The Biden Nuclear Posture Review declares that, quote, negotiation requires a willing partner operating in good faith, unquote. But if we don't have the partners we need, should we rend our garments and consign humanity to perpetual fear? Or should we plan and work and lead toward survival? Change is vanishingly unlikely if we are unprepared for it. The kind of inclusion that Drew called out in observing the challenge of peace is exactly what we need today. The defense establishment claims that continuity and ambiguity are vigorous virtues of today's nuclear war planning. They deflect hard questions and exclude dissent as dangerously erosive of some mystery of nuclear deterrence.
I don't want to risk being wrong about nuclear war any more than they do. But I'm not as sure as they are that they have it right. Drew observed that, quote, for good or ill, the challenge of peace taught Americans to reason and rationalize with the just war criteria, unquote. As we move forward, putting $100 billion worth of new intercontinental ballistic missiles in holes that my grandfather dug, we should refresh our understanding of the morality of nuclear war planning so that our grandchildren have at least a chance to make a different choice 70 years from now. We can celebrate the challenge of peace today by building on the inclusive cooperation that Drew observed. Defense officials should face hard questions about the morality of their nuclear war plans. Many have come to despair of any morality beyond the protection of nuclear terror. But I believe nuclear deterrence planners and nuclear disarmament champions share, to paraphrase James Turner Johnson, a searching distrust of nuclear war. We should strive to move beyond the frozen debate between nuclear deterrence and nuclear disarmament towards a future of nuclear discernment. A couple of years ago in Copley Formal Lounge, Nuclear Threat Initiative President Joan Rolfing imagined what a Catholic disarmament service would look like on the model of Catholic refugee services, highlighting that nuclear disarmament isn't just an idealistic dream for unicorns and fairies, but also a multi-generational practice of resisting the temptation to make an endless danger of human extinction the substitute for the peace that we should build together. 17 years ago, in the pages of America, the late Father Robert Drynan asked, would it be possible to educate and arouse America's 64 million Catholics to become a church that is a strong political force aimed at persuading the Congress and the White House to renounce and defuse nuclear weapons, end quote. Today, I ask you to consider all the ways the faith, work, and imagination of 1.3 billion Catholics worldwide could push back the hands of the doomsday clock and prevent a civilization-shattering nuclear war by asking hard questions, speaking up for the voiceless and the vulnerable, and devising solutions no one has thought of yet for living outside the shadow of the bomb. Georgetown could be a powerful spark plug for this global engine of peace. Looking out over this wise and powerful group gathered to carry forward the legacy of Father Drew Christiansen, I can't help but wonder, if it just happened that Drew could swing a miracle or two for us, what would we want those miracles to be? And what should we do to bring them about?
Well, thank you to all the panelists for a series of presentations that are both powerful and personal and very evocative. We don't have a lot of time left for questions and discussion, but I do want to ask one of my own before we invite the rest of the group for your responses. Drew Christiansen was a guest speaker in my classes at the law school more than once, and on one of those occasions, a student asked him a hard question. Question that was so hard that it stumped even Drew, and that's why I want to pose it to these three. And that is, how do you reconcile hope and fear in the nuclear realm, where Drew, as much as anybody, was attentive to the immense and today growing dangers of nuclear apocalypse? On the other hand, he profoundly had a deep and abiding sense of hope. How do you balance that? How do you reconcile? How do you bring those together?
The Lord has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a strong mind. One of the things I love about our particular faith tradition, it's not unique to our faith tradition, is bringing together reason and faith. We don't see those as separate or opposed. We see those as different streams that can get us to the same place. So if we're just looking at reason, there's a lot of reason to fear. But if you can look at it with, as David was saying, not only the intellect, but the affective side of faith, that's what makes it possible. But also, to me, The most unrealistic thing of all is expecting that things will stay the same. So the idea, you know, in a time of profound technological, economic, political, social, and fast change, that our nuclear weapons status quo would remain exactly the same is just ludicrous. So for me, that hope, that faith and reason come together in being able to manage that change with others.
Well, my political mentor, Alan Cranston, framed it a little differently. He said, when you look at the situation, you have a choice of terror or humor. Mm. I like the way Socrates looked at it. Socrates said, the rule of law has been misapplied to me, but I'm going to give my life to the community. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I know this is the right thing for me to do. And so he says, give me the hemlock, I'm not worried. And we're all beneficiaries of that. Jesus has got 12 disciples. He says, by the time the cock crows, there's going to be some problems. Doesn't bother him. So there's metrics of success of a personal level of your relationship to the small bit of time that we get to share together. There's metrics of integrity of the soul. And then there's metrics of the world. So I know this. Anybody who says they know what's going to happen in the world tomorrow is either a liar or a fool. And I also know that the happiest people that I've ever met are the people who live with the integrity of the qualities of the soul and put those first and say, what will love do? What will guide me? Knowing that they're going to die. So for me, it's not an issue of hope. It's an issue of identity with what it is to be human. And to live in fear is to forget that the gift of life is infinitely miraculous, filled with grace, that we live in a cosmos that's unimaginably magnificent, that we have consciousness, that we have friendship, that we have miracles. Or to live with the fear that everything you have, you're going to lose. Well, got to remind you, everything you have, you're going to lose, except the integrity of your soul. So that's how I view it.
So I had a perhaps inappropriate intrusive thought, David, when you asked the question. I for a moment glimpsed the sort of last scene in Dr. Strangelove.
Oh, yeah.
Slim Pickens is riding the bomb out of the B-52. and it made me think of the notion that, you know, sort of fear is the steed, but hope is the rider. Right now, he was misguided, obviously, but to do something about nuclear weapons policy, we have to engage it.
Yep.
The human capacity to do something, even in a despairing moment, is very vivid for me.
Thank you. Questions or comments? Rebuttals from the group?
I'm Peter Metz, and I'm from Boston. I'm not an academic, and I'm not a philosopher. I'm kind of a pragmatist activist.
I hope you feel welcome, nonetheless.
I realize I'm running some risks, so I want to challenge you guys and shoot a hole in some holes in what I've been thinking and what I had 4 hours on an airplane this morning to think even more about. We're obviously living in a time of incredible peril. It's gotten much more perilous. We know that war between the United States and Russia could wipe out all of humanity. We know that war between India and Pakistan could put 2 billion people at risk of starvation, including what most of us don't know is 130 million people in the United States. So it's incredibly perilous time, and it only seems to be getting worse. On the other hand, I think, and this is what I want you to shoot a hole in, I think we're sitting at a very opportune moment. Here we are, Catholic University. Many of us are Catholics. Those of you who are not are in good company with Drew Christiansen, who welcomed all. The world leader who speaks more about doing away with nuclear weapons is none other than Pope Francis, head of the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church, as you pointed out, is 1.3 billion people. Now, he's not alone anymore, okay? We've had Archbishop Wester, Archbishop Etienne, Bishop Malloy, all speak up in the last couple of months saying, we've got to do something about this, and they're trying to lead the way. And I hope more are coming. Anyway, think of 2 billion people, 1.3 billion people. Just ask for a small share of them to get concerned about it, okay? 10%? Not too much. 5%. 60 million people. Could the Catholic Church arouse 60 million people like Father Drinan from Massachusetts postulated? Now, we got one other ace in the hole, Joe Biden. Joe Biden knows more about nuclear weapons than any other president who's ever held the office, and probably than anyone who might hold the office in the future. He's been working on nuclear weapons since the third year of his senatorship. Joe Biden, in 2017, as he was leaving office, so he was completely free to speak his mind. He gave a speech, and in that speech he said, if we want a world without nuclear weapons, the United States must take the initiative to lead us there. He didn't say could or should, he said must. And then he went on to say, because we're the only nation to ever use them, we have a great moral responsibility. So here we sit as Catholics. Can we arouse the Catholic Church? Can we arouse Catholic Joe Biden? Maybe the Catholics of the United States and the Catholics of the world could make a difference in this, could get the leaders of the nine nations together, shoot a hole in it.
Maybe we'll reverse order. Doug, would you like to?
I don't have a hole to shoot in it. I think, President Obama gathered more heads of government than had been together at any time since the UN Charter was signed to engage in a series of nuclear security summits. I think we'd be well served to engage a series of nuclear deterrence summits or nuclear, to engage the question of what we're doing with nuclear deterrence on a global scale to try to find a better path forward.
John?
Cardinal Bevilacqua wrote a letter to Rick Santorum when the Chemical Weapons Convention was being held up in the Senate, and suggested that it would be appropriate for the senator who got a lot of Catholic votes on the abortion issue to similarly support the Holy See on the Chemical Weapons Convention. Shortly thereafter, the good senator had a press conference, rethought his position, and supported the Chemical Weapons Convention. We need more clerics to write senators and remind them of the position of the Holy See and thank them for supporting pro-life after birth.
Marianne?
I agree, and it's one of the things that Drew and we with the Catholic Peacebuilding Network have been working on in terms of engaging the next generation, in terms of getting this into educational curriculum. So I think there's a lot that could be done through these institutions, and the church brings a lot to it, not only the thought that you've mentioned, Peter, but also just the demographics. So we have the cross-cutting demographics of the non-nuclear weapon states that are Catholic, as well as those possessing nuclear weapons.
The last conference that Drew hosted on the subject, I proposed that that all Catholic institutions, as well as all other institutions that have a moral foundation, minimally adopt the investment standards that the country of Norway has. The Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund is the largest in the world, outperformed the market, and they put the money aside
for future generations, the windfall money they got from the oil in the North Sea. And they cannot invest it in enterprises that grossly violate human rights, that are environmentally destructive, or weapons of indiscriminate effect. So they can't invest in enterprises that profit from nuclear weapons. And of course, that stimulates a debate every year of what are those enterprises. But it focuses on the issue. And I made a suggestion that this university, for example, has a policy on climate, but it doesn't have a policy on investing in enterprises that benefit from weapons of indiscriminate effect, cluster munitions, landmines, and nuclear weapons. I think it would be great to have a debate here about that issue, to have an issue. Should Georgetown University have a portfolio of its funds that includes enterprises that benefit from nuclear weapons, landmines, and cluster munitions? Because clearly, the Holy Father would say, no, you shouldn't. And that, even just putting it out there, that debate could be transformative. So I'm formally suggesting that Georgetown begin that process and then challenge other faith-based institutions, churches, synagogues, mosques, to similarly at least have a moral foundation as good as a secular state, Norway. Because you have the model. And the argument used to be, oh, you know, our first duty is to maximize profits so we have quality education, scholarships, et cetera. That argument fails because of the success of the Norwegian sovereign fund. So that argument's off the table. And now the argument is, well, we will be morally neutral in our investing. We'll just do what's legal. Well, would you invest in pornographic films? It's First Amendment okay? Well, of course not. So I think it's ripe for the time, and I think that there's no holes in your argument.
Who's next?
Hi there. My name is Paul Eli. I'm a senior fellow in the Berkley Center, an author. I typically write about these issues for The New Yorker. So my question is for Professor Love. You would challenge Dorothy Day to, you said she's insufficiently strategic. My understanding is that she created the space or opened the space that the bishops worked in, that you all are working in, that Pope Francis is working in. How is that not strategic, and how can you improve on what she did personally?
Well, I don't want to say I can improve on Dorothy Day.
That's a hard
what
one.
I was really saying, though, is for the civil society actors who do public protest and witness, which is important, as you say, to open the space, to take that and connect that with the just peace approach that says, how is this strategic? What are the targets? What are the specific targets? What are the specific times? And I, you know, Dorothy Day is obviously deeply concerned for the poor. And the poor are where the nuclear weapons are sited and where they're suffering the most. So to connect those acts of protest and witness to these places of pain where we need to have defense conversion, that's really all I was saying.
Worker have not connected their witness for peace to places of pain in a way that the bishops have or that the people in this room have?
I'm not saying that one is better than the other. I'm saying that these places that are needed for defense conversion and trying to put attention to bringing economic resources into these impoverished communities to have defense conversion. That's what I'm saying.
Of course. I just don't understand how that works back into the insufficiency of strategic thinking on the part of Dorothy Day.
I'm not trying to signal that out. I was saying Mayors for Peace, they do a lot of work in trying to get different mayors to communicate that they want no nuclear weapons in their communities, and that groups like that, like the Catholic Worker, like others that do public protest, could be instead working together in ways that would focus on defense conversion.
You have time for one more question? Pierce.
Article 6.
State your name.
Sorry?
Identify yourself.
Pierce Gordon. from graduate of Georgetown, 1963.
An actor.
And currently supporting the Holy See mission in New York. If you look at the Non-Proliferation Treaty, which was cited as one of the critical elements for us, Article 6, which is often quoted for its commitments to nuclear disarmament, has a curious end where it puts those commitments within the framework of the negotiation of a treaty on complete and general disarmament. How does the conventional capabilities of states, in particular the bigger ones like China, the Russian Federation, and the United States, which the last time I looked has something like 11 aircraft carriers floating around the world, how does that impact overall on the perceptions and the ability to get rid of nuclear weapons?
Who would like to go first on that one?
Well, that's a okay. There's a legal issue here, so I'll you could.
You're doing fine.
Okay, thank you, Professor. The Article 6 of the NPT has a comma disjoining the duty of nuclear disarmament, comma, and general and complete disarmament under strict international controls. That's how it reads. And in 2000, the states parties to the treaty agreed to make an unequivocal undertaking to abolish nuclear weapons, making it clear that these two obligations are not contingent upon one another. They're both independent obligations. And general and complete disarmament, of course, in the United States, when you talk about disarmament, people think that it means giving up their hunting rifle. But it doesn't. It's a term of art. It means getting rid of offensive weapons. And so it's defined historically and legally in a very specific way. But I think Pierce, it's an aspiration within the treaty. The treaty itself is is aspirational. It doesn't say, like the International Court of Justice in interpreting the treaty said, that there's an obligation to negotiate and obtain legal instrument or instruments achieving the elimination of nuclear weapons, whereas the treaty, the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, just obligates good faith negotiations. And I would say the fulfillment of the good faith negotiations was evidenced by fulfilling the commitments made in the review conferences. But I think that's more on point about disarmament process is the obligation in Chapter 5, Article 26 of the United Nations Charter that says the Security Council shall convene the military staff committees to reduce arms expenditures and free up resources for social development. It doesn't say the Security Council may do that or it might consider doing it. It says it shall do it. It's a legal obligation in the treaty itself of the UN, the treaty of the UN Charter. And it's not subject to a veto. And yet the only time any president of the Security Council has ever suggested fulfilling it was Oscar Arias when he chaired it. I've questioned, I think, six presidents of the Security Council on this. And none of them had even studied it. But that I think to me is really on point. The duty of the Security Council to do that. And we should be pushing them.
Doug?
Arsenals of various types can be more or less dangerous. We know that. We should prefer less dangerous. We should prefer to move towards stability. And I think particularly sort of Amy Sands, who used to be provost at Monterey, observed that nuclear weapons technologies are largely mature, and most of the delivery platforms we use are mature technologies, whereas verification technologies are falling thick on the ground all around us. And that technological change has been insufficiently harnessed by the nuclear weapons states and by the rest of the NPT states parties who have the same Article 6 obligation. So I think that, yes, we've got to walk and chew gum, Absolutely. But I think that we're massively shortchanging the adoption of new technological means of verifying nuclear disarmament.
Thank you. Marianne, you get the last word.
I was just going to say that I do agree that we do have these new technologies that can be harnessed in better ways for peace, and that those are opportunities not only for governments to move forward on that, as you were talking about, pierce the governmental channels, but also for civil society to be able to move that forward. So we don't have to wait for governments to take action on these issues.
Please join me in thanking our panel.